This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: Wisdom S. Daughter, the life and love story of She Who Must Be Obeyed. Author: Henry Rider Haggard. Editor's note: What was the greatest fault of Ayesha, She Who Must Be Obeyed? Surely a vanity so colossal that, to take one out of many examples, it persuaded her that her mother died after looking upon her, fearing lest, should she live, she might give birth to another child who was less fair. At least, as her story shows, it was vanity, rather than love of the beauteous Greek, Callicrates, that stained the hands of She with his innocent blood, and amongst other ills, brought upon her the fearful curse of deathlessness while still inhabiting a sphere where death is lord of all. Had not Amenartes taunted her with the waning of her imperial beauty, eaten of the tooth of time, never would she have disobeyed the command of her master, the prophet Noot, and entered that fire of immortality which she was set to guard. Thus it seems that by denial, she would have escaped the net of many woes in which, perchance, she is still entangled, and of Ayesha, daughter of wisdom yet folly's slave, there would have been no tale to tell, and from her parable of the eternal war of flesh and spirit, there would have been no lesson to be learned. But vanity, or was it fate, led her down another road. The editor. Introductory. The manuscript of which the contents are printed here was discovered among the effects of the late L. Horace Holly, though not until some years after his death. It was in an envelope on which had been scribbled a direction that it should be forwarded to the present editor at the appointed time, words that at first he did not understand. However, in due course it arrived without any accompanying note of explanation, so that to this hour he does not know by whom it was sent or where from, since the only postmark on the packet was London, W., and the address was typewritten. When opened, the package proved to contain two thick notebooks, bound in parchment, or rather scraped goat or sheepskin, and very roughly as though by an unskilled hand, perhaps in order to preserve them if exposed to hard usage or weather. The paper of these books is extremely thin and tough, so that each of them contains a great number of sheets. It is not of European make, and its appearance suggests that it was manufactured in the East, perhaps in China. There could be no doubt as to who had owned these notebooks, because on one of them, the first, written in red ink upon the parchment cover in block letters, appears the name of Mr. Holly himself. Also on its first pages are various memoranda of travel evidently made by him, and no one else. After these follow sheet upon sheet of apparently indecipherable shorthand mixed up with tiny Arabic characters. This shorthand proved to belong to no known system, and although every effort was made to decipher it, for over 2 years it remained unread. At length, when all attempts had been abandoned, almost by chance, it was shown to a great Oriental scholar, a friend of the editor, who glanced at it and took it to bed with him. Next morning at breakfast, he announced calmly that he had discovered the key and could read the stuff as easily as though it were a newspaper leader. It seemed that the writing was an ancient form of contracted Arabic, mixed in places with the demotic of the Egyptians. A shorthand Arabic and a shorthand demotic, difficult at first, but once the key was found easily decipherable by some 6 or 8 living men, of whom, as it chanced, the learned scholar into whose hands it had thus fallen accidentally was one. So it came about that with toil and cost and time, at length those two closely written volumes were transcribed in full and translated. For the rest, they speak for themselves. Let the reader judge of them. There is but one thing to add. Although it is recorded in notebooks that had been his property, clearly this manuscript was not written by Mr. Holly. For reasons which she explains, it was written with the hand of She herself, during the period of her second incarnation, when at last Leo found her in the mountains of Thibet, as is described in the book called Ayesha. Chapter 1. The Halls of Heaven. To the learned man, ugly of form and face but sound at heart, Holly by name, a citizen of a northern land, whom at times I think that once I knew as Noot the Holy, that philosopher who was my master in a past which seems far to him, and is forgot, but to me is but as yesterday, to this Holly I say, I, who on earth am named Ayesha, daughter of Yarub the Arab chief, but who have many other titles here and elsewhere, have told certain stories of my past days and the part one played in them. Also I have told the same or other stories to my lord Callicrates, the Greek, now named Leo Vinci, aforetimes a warrior after the habit of his race and his forefathers, who for religious reasons became a priest of Isis, the great goddess of Egypt, and once I believed, my mother in the spirit. Also I have told these or different tales to one Alan, a wandering hunter of beasts and a fighting man of good blood who visited me at Kor. Though of this I said nothing to Holly or to my lord Callicrates, now known as Leo or the Lion, because as to this Alan I held it wiser to be silent. All these stories do not agree together, since often I spoke them as parables, or in order to tell to each that which he would wish to hear, or to hide my mind for my own purposes. Yet in every one of them lay hid something of the truth, a grain of gold in the ore of fable that might be found by him who had the skill and strength to seek. Now my spirit moves me to interpret these parables, and set down what I am and whence I came, and certain of the things that I have seen and done, or at the least such of them as I am permitted to reveal by those mightier than I of whom I am the servant, as they in their turn are the servants of others yet mightier than themselves. Here in these Asian caves I sit, the Hesia of the mountain, the last priestess of the worship of Mother Isis upon earth, as aforetime I sat amid the ruins of Kor in Libya. At Kor for 2,000 years I watched and waited till at length reborn, Callicrates, whom unwittingly I slew in a rage of jealousy, came back to me where I had slain him. There, because of the curse that is on me and him, I lost him again. For in this very place too I was slain most horribly, slain by an excess of life wherewith I thought to make myself more beautiful even than I was, and in striving to overfill the vase, shattered it to the vilest dust. Thus once more fate made a mock of me. Once more I lost Callicrates, whom it is my doom to desire in the flesh and to raise up in the spirit through time untold. My soul passed out and on, and here for a little while it found a home masked in the withered shape of an ancient priestess of my worship. As was foredoomed, my lord came back to me, and saw the shining soul within that hideous shape, and claimed it with a kiss, as I think the bravest deed and the most faithful that was ever done by man. In the magic of that kiss, as also was foredoomed, my beauty grew again before his eyes, so that once more I stand a glory upon earth. Now we are plighted, now, if all goes well, within a year we shall be wed, aye, within one short year after I have borne him back to Kor and unsealed the hidden fire of life and plunged him in its essence, giving to him my own gift of undying days. And yet, who knows the end? He presses me sore, and the starved woman part of me is passionate and weak, and I may yield, and if his lips touch mine, who can say but that the fire within me will destroy him, the unfortified, and bring all my plans to dust and nothingness? I am great, set far above mortals, yet I play against forces I cannot see that are greater than I, and it may please them to snatch the cup from my lips, and once more to overthrow me, for even though the blood of gods runs in him as it runs in all of us, who can stand against their master doom and its decrees? Therefore I, named Wisdom's daughter, named child of Isis, tonight am as full of fears as any mortal maid craving her lover beneath the moon and not knowing, but that war or chance or the vile breath of sickness may have borne him away into that gulf where all things must be lost, until they are found again. From month to month Leo my lord hunts upon the mountain after the fashion of men, and I, Ayesha, brood within the caves after the fashion of women. Yes, I who am half a goddess still brood within the caves after the fashion of women who wait and watch. Holly the instructed, who loves me, as all men must do, bides here with me in the caves, and we talk together of ancient things whereof the world has lost count, for he is a learned man skilled in the tongues of Greece and Rome, and one who thinks and perchance remembers. But yesterday he said to me that I, who seem to know the past, and to whom doors were opened that cannot be entered by human feet, should write down what I know and have experienced, that in time to come the world may be the wiser. This the fancy has taken me to do, though whether I shall persevere to the end, I cannot say. He has given me that wherein I can write. 'Tis not the old papyrus, but it will serve, and I have pens of reed and can make ink of various colors, who in the bygone days was no mean scribe. Also I sleep but little, whose body, filled like a cup with life, needs small rest. And the long hours of the night pass wearily for me, who lie and brood upon what has been and is to come, searching the darkness of the future with aching fearful soul. Moreover, I am able to write in characters which, with all his learning, Holly cannot read. I, who am not minded that he should know my thoughts and deeds, and betray them to my lord, whom they might cause to think the worse of me. Why then should I write at all? For this reason, in certain matters I have foreknowledge, and my spirit tells me that in a day to come, at the time appointed, some will guess the secret of my script, and render it into tongues that all may read, so that when, soon or late, upon the circle of my eternal path, I pass hence to whence I came, and like to the fire god in the caves of Kor-Am hid awhile, this record will remain my monument. Ah, there peeps out the mortal in me, for see, like any common man or woman I would not be forgot even among the passing dwellers in a petty world. Now to my task. I have a vision of what chanced to my soul before it descended to dwell on earth, and with it I will begin. Maybe it is but a parable, not to be strictly rendered, a token and a symbol rather than a truth. Yet of this I am sure that in it there is something of the truth. Since otherwise why through the long centuries did it return to me again and yet again? Mayhap Greece and Egypt had no gods save those they fashioned for themselves. Holly tells me, as did the wanderer Alan, who also had some smattering of knowledge, that Zeus and Aphrodite and Osiris and Horus and Ammon are now dethroned with all their company, and lie in the dust like the shattered columns of their temples, the mock of men who talk of them as the fables of the early world. So that of all the divinities that I knew, he of the Jews, although changed of character and countenance, alone is worshipped and remains. Doubtless it is so, yet while man lives, always there is God, though his shapes be many. Always there is the eternal good, as in a dream the holy Noot named the ultimate divine, and behold, it is called Ammon or otherwise. Always there is evil and behold, it is called Set or Baal or Moloch or otherwise. Always the stained soul of man seeks redemption, and he who saves is called Osiris or otherwise. Always nature endures, and she is called Isis or otherwise. Always the great world that will not die strains and pulses to new life, and the life-bringer is called Aphrodite or otherwise. And so on continually. Where man is, again I say, there was and is and will be God or good, the spirit named by many names. I go to my window place in this cave chamber, and look out upon the stars shining countless in the frosty sky, and lo, there I see God clad in one of the most glorious of his garments. I look at the moth flitting round my lamp or resting on the wall, and by the magic that is in it, summoning its mate from far, and lo, there I see God in another of his humbler garments. For God is in all things and everywhere, and from the great suns down to him who send them forth and to whom they return again, all that hath life must bow. This is the vision wherein I read a parable of eternal truths. I, Ayesha, daughter of Yarub, not yet of the flesh, but above and beyond the flesh inhabited the halls of that great goddess of the earth, a minister of that which rules all the earth, nature's self as now I know, who in Egypt was named Isis, mother of mysteries. Child, she named me, and messenger, and in that dream or parable as a child was I to her. For I drank of the cup of her wisdom and something of her greatness was in my soul. The goddess sat brooding in her sanctuary, where spirits came and went, bearing tidings from all lands or emptying at her feet the cups of offered prayer. About her fell her robes blue as the sky, and over the robes hung down her hair dusky as the night, and beneath her bent brows shone her eyes like stars of the night. In her hand was the rod of power, and the footstool at her feet was shaped like the round world. There, canopied with light, she sat upon an ebon seat and brooded while round her beat music like sea waves upon the shore, such music as is not known upon the earth. I appeared. I stood before her, I abased myself, I bowed till my forehead lay upon the ground and my hair swept the dust of the ground. She touched me with her scepter, bidding me arise. Speak, child, she said. What message dost thou bring from the shores of Nile? How goes my worship in the temples of Isis, and are my servants faithful to my law? Then I made answer. O Mother Divine, I have accomplished my embassy. Unseen, a spirit, I have wandered through the land of Egypt. I have visited thy temples, I have hearkened to the counsels of thy priests, I have watched thy worshippers and read their hearts. This is my report. Thy holy temples are empty, thy priests neglect thine altars. Save a remnant who remain faithful, thy worshippers bow themselves before the shrines of another goddess. How is this goddess named, O child of my love and wisdom? She is named Aphrodite of the Greeks, a people who have flowed into Egypt, also other folk know her as Ashtoreth and Venus. Her sanctuary of sanctuaries is at Paphos in Cyprus, an island of the sea over against Egypt. She is the queen of earthly love, and love is the ritual of her worship, and she makes a mock of thee, O mother, and of all the ancient gods, thy brothers and sisters, swearing that thy day and theirs is done, and that she has risen from the sea to rule the world and will rule it to the end. Here and there she reveals herself and conquers by her beauty, making all men to worship her and teaching all women to follow in her steps and beguile as she does, so that thy very priests turn to her and thy priestesses break from their vows and wanton with them. All of this I have learned, O child, and more, yet it was my desire to hear it from thy lips that cannot lie, since in thee dwells my spirit. Hearken now. I am minded to be avenged upon these false Egyptians, and thou shalt be the sword of vengeance wherewith I will smite them, bringing their ancient glory to the dust, and forever setting the yoke of bondage on their necks. I am so minded, and it shall be done, how, I will teach thee afterward. But first, as I have the power to do, I, who under the strength above me am regent of the ball of earth, will summon this Aphrodite to my presence here and now, and bid her speak out her heart to me. Hear me, Aphrodite, wherever thou art in earth or heaven. Aphrodite, I bid thee appear. Then in my vision, the mother rose from her throne. Standing before it, terrible to see, she beckoned with her scepter, north and south and east and west, uttering the secret words of power. Thrice she beckoned, and thrice she spoke the secret words and waited. There was a stir at the end of the great hall, and a sound of singing. Behold, floating between the long lines of the flame-clad guardians of that hall, attended by her subject gods, her maenads and her maidens, a shape of naked loveliness, came Aphrodite of the Greeks. Veiled in her curling locks and roped about with gleaming pearls for necklace and for girdle, she stood before the throne and bowed to the majesty it bore, then asked in a laughing voice of music, I have heard thy summons, Mother of Mysteries, and I am here. What wouldst thou of me, Isis, Queen of the World? How can the sea-born whose name is beauty and whose gift is love, serve thee, Isis, Queen of the World? Thus thou who art shameless, thou born of the new gods and fashioned from the evil that is in the race of men, by lifting thy spell from off my worshippers. I know thy works. Drunken with desires they flock to thee in troops, and for reward thou givest them the wages of their sin. Thou layest waste their homes, thou defilest their maidens, thou turnest men to beasts and mockest a mock of them. Thy flowers fade, thy joys fill the mouth with ashes, and those who drink of thy cup suck up poison in their souls. Thy fair flesh is a rottenness, and thy perfumes are a stench, and the incense of thine altars is the reek of hell. Therefore I command thee, go back to whence thou camest and leave the world in peace. Whither then should I go, mother? Answered Aphrodite with her silvery laugh, save into thy bosom, whence indeed I sprang, seeing that thou art nature's self and I am thy child. Stern is thy law and sweet, yet without me thou wouldst have none over whom to rule. I, without me, would no child be born, and not even a flower would blow. Without me, thou wouldst rule a wilderness with but the wisdom of which thou boastest to keep thee company. Hearken. We are at war, and in that war one shall be conqueror, for I am eternal, and all life is my slave, because my name is life. Get thee to thy heaven, Isis, and rule there with Osiris, lord of death, but leave me the living. Soon their day is done, and they pass beyond my spells into thy dominion. There treat them as thou wilt and be content, for then I have no more need of them, nor they of me. Why of a sudden art thou so wrath with me, whom thou hast known from the beginning? Is it because I take new names and set up my altars in thine own Egypt, altars wreathed with flowers, leaving all desolate thine where prayers are mumbled from starved hearts and cold hands make the offering of denial. Come now, Mother Isis, let us play a game and let Egypt be the stake. Thou hast the vantage there, seeing that for eons it has bowed to thy laws, and thy yoke has been upon its neck. What then, O Aphrodite, dost thou promise Egypt to which I and those who rule with me have given greatness, wisdom, and hope beyond the grave? None of these high things, Mother. My gifts are love and joy, sweet love and joy in which for a little while all fears are forgot. Small gains thou mayest think, looking backward to the past and onward to the future, thou whose eyes are upon eternity. Yet they shall prevail. Isis, in Egypt thy day is done, there as elsewhere thy scepter falls. If so, wanton, with it falls Egypt that henceforth shall be the world's slave. When conqueror after conqueror sets his foot upon her neck, then let her think on Isis whom she has forsaken, and wailing, fill her soul with thy swine's food. Lo! I depart, leaving my curse on Egypt. Have thy little day till before the judgment seat we settle our account. No more will I listen to thy falsehoods and thy blasphemies. Till then, wanton, look on my majesty no more. So in that vision spoke the mother and was gone. With her, flashing like lightnings, went the flame-clad guardians that attend the goddess, leaving the great place empty save for Aphrodite and her throng, and for the soul of me, Ayesha, who watched and hearkened, wondering. The Paphian looked around and laughed, then glided to the vacant throne, and seating herself thereon, laughed again, till the music of her mockery echoing from pillar to pillar filled all the temple's halls. "It is an omen," she cried. "What Isis leaves I take, henceforth her seat and power are mine. See now my ministers, I queen it here, though I wear no vulture cap or symbols of the moon, whose brow is better graced by these abundant locks, and whose scepter is a flower whereof the odors make men mad. Yes, I queen it here as everywhere, though in this solemn melancholy fane I lack a subject." She glanced about her till her glorious roving eyes fell upon that spirit, which was I. "Come hither thou," she said, "and do me homage." Now in my dream I, that spirit who in the worldom named Ayesha, came and stood before her, saying, "Nay, I am the child of Isis, and to her I bow alone." "Thinkest thou so?" she answered, smiling and looking me up and down. "Well, I have another mind. It seems to me that soon thou wilt descend from this sad realm to the joyous fields of earth, that there thou mayest fulfill a certain purpose, for such is the fate decreed for thee. Now I, Aphrodite, add to that fate, and lighten it. Look behind thee, spirit that shall be woman." I turned and looked, there to behold a shape of beauty that I knew for man. So beautiful was he that my breast rose, and the life in me stood still. He smiled at me, and I smiled back at him. Then he was gone, leaving his picture stamped upon my soul. This is what I add to that tragic fate of thine, O spirit that shall be woman. Take him, the man appointed to thee, who from the beginning was always thine, and as perchance thou hast done before, in his kiss forget thy mother Isis and thy crown of woes. Thus this vision ends, and though now I, Ayesha, have learned that Isis, as we knew and named her in the ancient time, is but a symbol of that eternal holiness which is set above all heavens and all earths, I say again that, as I believe, in its parable is hid something of the changeless truth. VVV Chapter 2. Noot the Prophet comes to Ozal. Such is the vision, such the dream that has haunted me through the centuries, and brooding over it from age to age, I, Ayesha, doubt not that in its substance it is true, though its trappings may be fancy wrought. At least this I know, that my spirit is the child of immortal wisdom, such as once men believed that Isis held, as my undying shape is born of the beauty that is fabled Aphrodite's gift. At least it is certain that even before I dipped me in the fire of life, the most of learning and all human loveliness were mine. I know also that it was my mission to bring Egypt to the dust, and did I not bring it to the dust, smiting to its heart through proud Sidon and Cyprus, Aphrodite's home? And have I not for these deeds borne Aphrodite's curse, as because of Aphrodite's yoke laid upon my helpless neck, I have borne and bear the curse of Isis, I whose destiny it is thus at once to be the instrument and sport of rival powers whose battleground is the heart of every one of us. Alas, Were my tale known, the world in its haste might judge me hardly, and think that I, who by burning its Phoenician props overturned an ancient empire, am cruel-natured, or that because I sought the love of a certain man and in my anger slew him when he turned from me, which in truth I did not desire to do, that I am wanton and ungoverned. Yet these things are not so, seeing that it was fate, not I, that gave Egypt to the Persian dog, whom in his turn I overthrew, and made of its people slaves, and my flesh, not I, which after I had tasted of the fire that is nature's soul, cursed me with passion and its fruits, perchance because I hated it, and would never bow myself to it wholly, I who followed after purity, desiring not man's love, but wisdom's gifts and a crown of spiritual gold. Moreover, I had earthly and righteous warrant to bring about Sidon's fall and through it that of Egypt, seeing that their kings would have put me to utter shame, and robbed my father of his life, as shall be told. So too, I had the warrant of a woman's heart to worship the man I sought, and for the death I brought upon him in my jealous madness, my soul has paid full measure in remorse and tears. Still, since justice is hard to come by here on the earth, or even in the heaven above, I know that some would judge me harshly and must bear it with the rest. Even Holly, and at times my lord Leo, who once was named Callicrates, have cherished such thoughts, though their lips dare not utter them, for I read it in their minds, which to me are as an open book. Therefore never shall Holly, nor my lord either, look upon this written truth, lest therefrom they might distill some poison of mistrustful doubt, for it is sure that all men stain the whiteness of pure verity to the color of their twisted minds. Therefore too, I write it in tongues and symbols that they do not understand, which yet shall be deciphered in their season. As I taught Holly long ago in the caves of Kor, and truly, though afterward for some forgotten reason of my own or to give him food for thought, I may perhaps have changed my tale, puzzling him with stories of great Alexander and the rest. By my mortal birth, I am an Arabian of the purest and most noble blood, born in Yaman the Happy and in the sweet city of Ozal. My father was named Yarab after the great ancestor of our race, and I, his only child, was named Ayesha after my high-born mother. Of her whom I never knew, for she was gathered to the bosom of whatever god she worshipped, but one moon from my birth, this is said. At first she would not look on me, being angered because I was not a son, but at length at my father's pleading she was prevailed upon to command that I should be brought to her. When she saw how fair a babe heaven had given her, such a babe as had not been known or told of among our people, she was amazed and put up a prayer that she might die. This, those who knew her declared, she did for two reasons. First, because, foreseeing my greatness, she desired that I alone should hold my father's heart and that of all our tribe, and secondly, because she feared lest, should she live, she might bear other children whom she would hate when she compared them to my perfectness. So it came about as, amongst others, my father told me often, that her prayer was granted, and having kissed and blessed me, for a while she entered into rest. This is the true story of her end, not the other, which those who envied me put about in after days, that owing to certain revelations which came to her at the time of my birth, as to the deeds which I was doomed to do, and the loves and hates which I was doomed to earn, my mother thought it better to ask death from her gods rather than to continue in a life which she must live out at my side. This tale my father often swore to me when I asked him of it, was as false as the changeful pictures which are seen at sunset on the desert, and sometimes at noonday also. For the rest, this beloved father of mine took no other wife while I was yet a child, fearing lest for her own sake, or her children's, she should be jealous and maltreat me, and afterward, when I became a maiden, because I would not suffer that another woman should share the rule of his household with me. As I showed to him, he had servants in plenty, and these should be enough, to which he bowed his head and answered that without doubt my will was that of God. Thus it came about that I grew up with my noble father, his adviser and his strength, and through him, or rather with him, ruled all his great tribe who always worshipped me. Be it admitted that from the first, or at least from the time that I came to womanhood, I brought him trouble as well as blessing, though through no fault of my own, but because of the beauty with which, as in those days I believed, Isis or Aphrodite or both of them had endowed me for their own divine purposes. Very soon this beauty of mine, also my wit and knowledge, were noised abroad through all Arabia, so that princes came from far to court me, and afterward quarreled and fought, for being gentle-hearted, I said a kind word to every one of them and left them to reason out which was the kindest. This, for the most part, they did with spears and arrows after the fashion of violent.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.